There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise right out of the ground. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Well, look way down the river. What do you think I see? I see a band of angels, and they're coming after me. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. Body down. Well, meet me, mother and father. Meet me down the river road. And mama, you know that I'll be there when I check in, my Lord. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down. There ain't no grave can hold my body down.
If you've ever heard someone say, I carry a 45 so I don't have to shoot twice, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Guys, like and comment. The comment section is utterly and completely out of control and uncontrollable. Get down there, find out what is the most important comment section in all of the firearm community. If you're looking to support the channel, the biggest support of the channel right now is Big Daddy Unlimited. Big Daddy Unlimited is like the Costco of the gun world. You get sick prices, but you have to buy a 99 cents for the first month. Link right below. Appreciate you guys. If you're looking for sick bags, plaid, gloves, Vertex, and of course, LAX ammunition for all your ammunition needs, discount code GRANDTHUMB. Ladies and gentlemen, this particular video is brought to you by Simply Safe, so big thank you to them. We'll talk more about them later. Ladies, gentlemen, am I often forgotten, but not by me, Super Cobras, welcome to the channel. Today we're gonna be talking about the M45A1. This is an M1911 variant that was recently adopted and then recently is kind of falling out of favor. We're talking about this, about the internals and all that goodness about it. Now, like I always do, let's go ahead and let's do full disclosure. So full disclosure on this, I have no relationships to Colt. I do like many other products. I don't even think their marketing department knows who I am. But this particular firearm, I did buy them with my own cold, hard-earned cash, and the ammunition was provided for by me, and nobody helped me with jack shit. So, yep, there's the disclosures as far as my relationships with those companies. So let's go ahead and let's get into it. So before we start on it, being an M1911 variant, I feel the need to talk a little bit about that. Now, if you're not familiar with the 1911, the 1911 was in service with the United States military still. And most recently by the Marine Corps, but it used to be the standard issued handgun of the United States military for quite a while, with everybody pretty much except for the Air Force during the Vietnam War, because they wanted to carry a revolver for whatever reason. People tend to wax very poetic and very nostalgic when it comes to the M1911. I think that is due to a variety of factors. The factors that it served in so many wars despite its age, and the fact that when it was adopted, it was adopted for a very different reason compared to the M9. So when the M1911 was adopted in the Philippine-American War, we were having a lot of trouble with the man-stopping power of the ammunition that was being used. I believe it was a 38 long Colt or something along those lines. So when the M1911 was adopted, it was adopted for its man-stopping power, it was adopted for its sheer reliability. The original M1911, when it went through the military trials, was fired 6,000 rounds over like 2 days, and they dunked it into water to cool it off, and it had zero malfunctions. So that was pretty astounding for the time. It's kind of one of the early first self-loading firearms, and it's designed by the god himself, John Moses Browning. So a lot of people just love this handgun. I mean, there are stories galore of the M1911, of pilots parachuting and using their 1911 to shoot a Japanese pilot during World War II. I don't know if any of these stories are true, but the 1911 has been around for so long, people just love it. So understand, with anything that I say about it, don't get angry. I'm just gonna review this impartially like I always do, and I'm gonna compare it directly to modern service handguns, because the fact of the matter is that this is still in service, and I think it needs to be compared because it's competing against modern service handguns nowadays. So without further ado, let's go ahead and let's get into it. So the M45A1 was adopted by the Marine Corps for MARSOC and a couple other specialty units, Force Recon and VBSS and all those types of guys. In 2012. It replaced an earlier model that they were using of the 1911 that was specialized for those duties. But in any case, 2012, it's picked up. It's later dropped around 2016 and replaced with the Glock 19. That was not because it wasn't performing very well, but we will talk about that, but specifically because they wanted to standardize among other special operation units who were using the Glock 19. Now, despite that, many units are still in possession and still field these weapons because, as you know, it takes the military a monumental amount of time to replace anything. Now, before we get into this, I want to talk a little bit about the service of this weapon. So, I have no experience with this weapon in the service. This was never used in my job or anything along those lines. But I am lucky to have a variety of individuals who serve and have served in MARSOC, Force Reconnaissance, and other units that have a lot of time in these. And the most common thing I hear is that when these were released, it was generally considered by these men to be criminal because of how poorly they were produced. And the general complaint was that the finish was not good. The finish wore off and it flaked off. And then when combined with the lubrication in the weapon, turned into this weird sludge that would get stuck around in the gun and cause it to gum up. Specifically for a lot of guys, it would get into the trigger mechanism and prevent the trigger from resetting. So a lot of these guys have a very bad taste in their mouth for the M45A1, the green weenie struck again. So I understand that. Now that being said, in 2016, they updated the model and I think corrected a lot of those problems. So we're gonna talk about the updated model, but do bear in mind for a lot of you that absolutely hate the M45 for those reasons that they're absolutely warranted, but they have been corrected. So let's go ahead and let's get into it. The M45A1 is essentially the Colt railgun with a couple key differences in color, finish, sights and a couple other things. So we're going to go ahead, we're just going to take this as a brand new gun. We're not going to really compare it to the Colt railgun and we're just going to roll through it. So to start off, the M45A1 is a M1911 style recoil operated handgun. Fires from a single stacked magazine, which is we will talk about later. But for now, let's start from tip to butt like we always do. So starting off, barrel. We have a National Match barrel, 5 inches in length. This is a full-size M1911. What does that mean? If you're unfamiliar, well, the M1911 is a very accurate weapon system, in my opinion. In fact, I would argue that it is a more accurate firearm compared to many modern service weapons like the Glock and M18 and M17. I will do a test in the very near future on this, comparing all these weapons. But the barrel is phenomenally accurate. So I started off by doing a quick test, 50 yards, draw, fire on, reduced size, steel silhouette. It's not a terribly hard shot, but I just wanted to point, the gun is absolutely accurate. As you can see, no problem. I wanted to do this test because talking to older World War II vets or Korean War vets, they're quick to say that the M1911 was absolutely useless past 15 yards. And I think that was due to the terrible sights that were on the older M1911s, but the 1911 M45A1, 45 ACP is absolutely a good caliber out past 15 yards. It definitely still carries its weight. So don't believe that it's not effective at all once it gets past a certain distance. So, barrel, more accurate than you, more accurate than me. We are the weak link when it comes to accuracy on this weapon. Moving down from there, we have a very interesting recoil mechanism on the M45A1 and on the Colt railgun. It is a dual recoil assembly. Essentially, you have two springs working in conjunction to reduce the amount of force that you feel. This isn't a new concept, but it was used very well in this particular firearm. As far as how effective is it? Well, I think it comes down to two things. A lot of reviewers have said this gun is so soft when you shoot it, and it's amazing, that type of thing. Well, we have to consider two things because yes, you have this recoil reducing mechanism in here, but also you have this very thick with 3C's rail. This weapon is actually heavier than a standard 1911. It specifically adds weight right out front. It weighs in around 2.5 as opposed to about 2.3, 2.4 pounds. So understand that this extra weight added up front definitely aids in recoil mitigation. So when I'm firing this, the weapon definitely does feel very soft compared to a normal 1911. So compared to like the super ultra Gucci Nighthawk Custom Enforcer, it feels a little softer than it with a combination of weight and the recoil spring assembly. I don't know which adds to it more. Weight definitely always brings recoil down on a weapon. At the same time, you have more to carry around. In any case, the M45A1 is definitely one of the more pleasurable 1911s I've had the opportunity to shoot due to how soft the recoil impulse due to the weight. It's not huge, but if you've been firing a lot of rounds, you can definitely notice the difference between these two weapons when firing. That being said, this weapon is also heavy, so I definitely have all that fucking weight right on my hip, and that's not the best thing. I have a big iron right on the hip. And that's not the best thing to have to deal with. So there are, you know, pros and cons when it comes to the M45A1. Speaking of all of that, let's talk about the rail since we're right on that subject. So the rail is a full M1913 rail, as opposed to some of the more abbreviated, more universal rails that you see on Glocks and many 1911s. So I've seen a lot of reviewers say, wow, this is such a secure mounting platform. And I'm not sure about that. Most firearms that I've used don't really have any problems and they use the universal rail. So I don't believe that it specifically adds any, you know, like tangible benefits, but I will say that the weight added right out front definitely helps with recoil. So we have that very thick with 3C's rail. Okay, talking about the finish really quick again. So we have an ion bonded finish, which was changed in 2016 from the earlier finish that wore off quite a bit. The ion bonded finish that is on this weapon, the specific one, is not as corrosion resistant, but is much more durable. So I think it was a good trade-off. I've had no problems with this particular finish. I've used this for about 2K rounds and it's been running very well. Another interesting note here, and I'm sure this is gonna cause a lot of arguments as soon as I point this out, but this particular weapon says Colt **M45A1. Many of the very early ones said Colt **, United States Marine Corps, USMC. And then on many weapons that are decommissioned, it says, you know, Colt, and then the USMC is crossed out. Later on, the United States Marine Corps asked that Colt no longer put USMC on there and just put M45A1. So all new production weapons simply say M45A1. There are several different versions of this model, speaking of which. Your typical military and civilian versions come off the same production line, so they are the same gun. Now, there is a different gun you can get that is from the Colt Custom Shop that is one of these that is all Gucci'd out. I don't have that one. This is just the standard military-civilian model. They're the same freaking gun. Okay, moving from there, we have our front slide serrations. So when it comes to the M45A1, the front slide serrations are very deep, very aggressive. It's easy to get into them. I'm not going to argue right now about the viability of front sight serrations other than to say that I like them for clearing malfunctions and press checking. And yes, it is necessary to press check at times. Of course, it can be a little larpy if you do a little too much. Quick note. But it is good. Now, here's the problem. The entirety of the weapon, both the slide serrations, the safety, everything, the rails, it's sharp. So the problem with that, I know you saw the blood on there, that was from something else. The sharpness tends to wear through holsters. For example, I have the 6004 right here, Safariland holster. I've already worn out a lot of the lining inside here. It's definitely torn it up, and at times it's ripped it up, so the gun's kind of gotten locked in there. So it's kind of a problem. I would have wished that Colt would have perhaps dehorned it a little bit more, and that's something that perhaps I'll have done to this weapon in the future to make it a little bit more carry friendly. And I know I'm comparing it to something that's unfair. This is a much more expensive weapon, but you can definitely feel the difference in a weapon that's dehorned. It's definitely nicer to grip and to manipulate and to work with and to holster and unholster, because it's not like ripping shit out of the holster when you're drawing it out. In any case though, it is aggressive, just like my Marines out there. I know you guys are gonna have no problems. You're gonna cut your hand. You're gonna be like, ugh, and like draw with it or something. Because anyhow, I'm sure Marines have no problems with it. I'm probably a little bit of a bitch. All right, moving back from there, we have our sights. The sights are Novak sights. Awesome, Novak sights, no issues there. The front sight is a little bit thicker and the rear sights are a little bit thinner than I typically want. I typically prefer Heine or 10-8 sights. I know I keep bringing this up, but that's what I prefer. They do have tritium in them. Awesome, you have your night sights, perfectly adequate. I prefer different sights, but for combat marksmanship and combat shooting, they are more than adequate. They take a little bit of getting used to if you're not used to Novak sights, but once you do, they are spot on. Again, made shots at 50 and 75, no problem with this particular handgun. I've done out to 100 with it. Fortunately not on film, therefore it's not real. A lot of people have asked, you know, why are they doing this peanut butter color? Because the Marines keep eating it, they don't know if it's food or not. Well, that's a good question. So the reason that they're going with more of a tan, more natural look to many firearms is the fact that since the Korean War, since the Vietnam War especially, when black guns started really coming into play, black guns really stick out in nature. This has been noted by many, from the Vietnam War all the way to the Rhodesian War and into the war in Afghanistan and Iraq. Many people have noted how black guns stick out and they're easy to point out and then identify a target. So by camouflaging weapons, this is something that the Rhodesians did, or taping rifles up and that type of stuff, you break up the silhouette. So having a tan gun or something for many of the environments that we're in right now definitely makes sense. And I understand it's confusing for my Marines, but I think you guys are gonna survive. I know you guys hear me making fun of Marines a lot. You might be getting super aggro right now if you're a Marine veteran, but let it be known that I fucking love my Marines and they rock. They are savages and they drink the blood of their enemies, and I am fucking damn pleased that they are on our side. So here's to you, Marine Corps. Okay, moving from there, we have our slide release. So, or slide stop. I had somebody argue with me very passionately about the slide release versus slide stop. Spoiler alert, no one gives a fuck. So anyhow, the slide release, standard, just like any other 1911. Now, if you're not familiar with a 1911, reloading or emergency reload off a 1911 is a little bit interesting. So first off, you should be managing your ammunition. So you shouldn't be going to slide lock. You should simply be managing your ammunition and topping off when necessary. But if you do go dry and you lock back, what you're gonna do is you're going to, well, there's several different ways to reload. The way I typically run it is you drop the magazine. Once that empty magazine is out, you're drawing out your fresh one, inserts. Once it inserts, due to how far the slide release is from my thumb, I typically use my support side thumb, and as I'm getting my grip, I drop it and I just bring my thumb right up. That's pretty typical. And I thought it was crazy when I was doing that at first, until I saw Larry Vickers do it. So Larry did it the same way. Larry Vickers, as you know, has quite a bit of experience using the 1911 in real world operations. I've seen many other people do this, so I know I'm not crazy. Now, if you have monster hands and you can reach your thumb all the way over there, when you do the reload without breaking your grip too much, you can simply insert and then drop immediately, just like you do with a Glock or many other modern service weapons. But for the majority of us who are normal size, and if you're that big and you can reach your hands around, that's not a good thing. You're like a monster. Nobody wants to be near you. Then good. Then just rock on with doing that. Quick note too, before we go on, I know I hit so many quick notes, but you'll notice that when I'm dropping my slide hard, I'm using a snap cap or something to load something into the chamber. Now, I've heard multiple things about this. Should you or should you not drop the slide on an empty chamber in a 1911? Some gunsmiths have told me yes. Some have told me no. Some have told me I don't know, I don't care. Now, I just tend to err on the side of caution, and if I'm going to be dropping the slide, I drop it with a snap cap in, or I ease it down just like this. Just be nice to your guns. The 1911, has some little quirks to it, and that's one of those quirks. I would recommend using snap caps or lowering your slide gently if you have to. The safety is one really cool thing about the M45A1. So a good safety on a weapon that requires one, like the 1911, is important that it feels nice. The M45A1, its safety, we're gonna ghost it, feels really nice. It's a very positive, just a gentle amount of pressure, and when you draw your handgun out and you get your grip, your thumb will just naturally drop right down onto that and it just clicks right off. It's beautiful. Compare that to the Super Gucci Enforcer right here. It has a larger safety. However, it's a little bit stiffer, and I've put a lot of rounds through both of these. So it just doesn't feel quite as good. So I've been really impressed with how well the safety is designed on this and how good it feels. Colt definitely got it right when it comes to that. Okay, moving from there, we have VZ grips right here. I know a lot of people are really hot in these grips. They're like, oh my God, they're so beautiful. I'm kind of ambivalent towards them. I think that they look okay in my opinion. But in any case, the grips are good. They do provide a lot of grippiness, which is important. They're made from VZ, and I expect nothing else of those savages. I love the guys at VZ. We have a little inlet portion right there that gets you right to the magazine release. Magazine release is no problem. Magazines eject positively and smoothly. Now, I'm going to talk about it because I always do, but the grip on the 1911, specifically the grip angle, the height of the beaver tail right here, and everything comes together. It gives you such a nice high grip that the 1911, in my opinion, is unrivaled in ergonomics. Every time I pick up the 1911 and I bring it to my eyes, I just have a perfect sight picture, and it just works for me very well. It lends itself to shooting fast and accurately, and it just works very well for me. I've always loved the way that a 1911 points. Again, John Moses Browning and me, we're like two peas in a pod. We're like the same person, apparently, or maybe we're built the same, like Gumby. And because all of his weapons fit me very well. But yeah, I just love the way that the M1911 points. Now, there are a couple problems here. The front strap right here of the grip lacks any type of stippling or any type of grip material. This is something that I would have wished they had added to this particular weapon, especially for a combat handgun. It's a little bit puzzling. I know, super gooched out, but stippling adds a lot of grip to the 1911 that is absolutely necessary on slick metal, especially on these with their iron bonded finish. It's very slick, so I wish they would have had something. Now, I don't really give a fuck about putting stuff on my gun, so I usually end up adding some grip tape or something right up front here. That way I can kind of grip into the gun a little bit harder. There's companies that make them, like Talon grips or whatever. I use them on a lot of my guns, but if you're gonna use this for a serious use and hold on for that. If you use it for serious use, then you wanna add grip tape of some type there. All right, so I've avoided it as much as I can, but let's go ahead and let's go trigger. If you're unaware of triggers on the 1911s, 1911s have the best triggers of any service handgun I've ever fired. They're just phenomenal. They're light, they're crisp, they're short, the reset is short, and they lend themselves to an accurate shot. I've seen a lot of people who say the trigger doesn't matter. They're like, it doesn't matter, you can train through it. And you can train through many things, but if you believe that a trigger doesn't matter, get out there with a Glock with a 12-pound trigger and tell me it's as good as a 1911. Trigger or something like that, and you can shoot just as fine and as accurately. I'm sure you can, but not without a lot more muscular tension and those types of things, which can degrade accuracy. So triggers matter, in my opinion. And again, like I've always said, if I can have something that makes me a better shooter without affecting reliability of a weapon, why wouldn't I add it? That absolutely goes for triggers. So people who say triggers don't matter, it's whatever. All right, let's go sit, play Unchained Melody. Let's do this. All right, so first off, you've got a 0.5mm play right there. Easily 5 pounds. All right, let's check the reset. Perhaps 1mm, a little less. 5 pounds. Actually, I already checked on the Lyman pull gauge, so it is 5 pounds, but very crisp. 1911 triggers have often been described as breaking a thin glass rod, and they just feel phenomenal. Just a really well-designed trigger, and that goes absolutely, that is absolutely the case when it comes to the M45A1. It could be better, but when it comes to a combat trigger, that is absolutely adequate. Money, love it. All right, grip safety, I wish they didn't have them, but they do right there. If you don't have the grip safety depressed, you can't pull the weapon, it has to be depressed before you can depress that trigger. So it's an unfortunate part of 1911s, part of their design. It's one thing I don't really like about them. But again, you should have a good grip, but shit happens sometimes. Hammer, good to go, no issues there. Now, if you have a firearm like this, make sure that you're keeping it safe. You guys know this video is sponsored by Simply Safe. So a quick note from them. I've been using Simply Safe for a long time. Why? Because I can add piecemeal what I need to beef up my security system as needed. There's a lot of people who just can't drop a couple $1,000. For most people, you gotta do it. A little bit of time would make a lot more sense. And that's what I did with Simply Safe. So I could add in door sensors and window brake sensors and video cameras and what have you as needed. So for example, when I started setting up like a gun room, in addition to some other security measures on the windows and doors, I also added and video cameras in there from Simply Safe because I could simply add it and integrate it with my system. And it's for that reason that I think it works very good for firearm enthusiasts and guys who have weapons in their home and that type of thing. It allows you to kind of have a little bit more peace of mind of what's happening and have some evidence of other stuff that might occur. So Simply Safe, highly recommend it. Get down there, link right below. Thank them for supporting this video. Let's get back to the M45A1. Okay, so we've gone over all that. Let's talk a little bit about magazines. So I know that's gonna come up. So what magazines do I use? Because one thing that kind of bites the 1911 in the ass every time is this magazine capacity. Running off a single stack magazine, The most you can get, and this is with like one of them Stendo mags, is 10 rounds. So you have 10 in the magazine, one in the chamber for a total of 11. That's in stark contrast to say a Glock 21, which is a 45 caliber Glock pistol. With its standard capacity magazine, we're talking 13 rounds. Then extended, as much as this one extends out the butt of this gun, we're talking closer to 17 or 18 rounds. So you have almost double the capacity. Now, a lot of people say, oh, magazine capacity doesn't matter because if you have to take more than 8 shots or 7 shots in a gunfight, then you're a bad shot. It's not true, but you can live in fantasy land. Reloading sucks. If you can have a gun that you don't have to reload as much, absolutely. And that is the one problem with this. So standard magazines that fit flush are typically 8 rounds. So for a total of 9 with one in the chamber. Otherwise, I typically rock the 10 rounders. As far as what magazines work, ACT mags, the Chip McCormick Power mags, and the Wilson Combat mags have all been excellent. So we have the Chip McCormick Extendos. We have the Wilson Combat 10 rounders. Here are the ACT mags, Power mags. These are the 8 rounders. They work fine. So I've had no problems with any of these through about 2K of shooting. So I can definitely recommend them in this particular weapon. It seems to love all those magazines that I've mentioned. And I know there's other good ones, but those are the ones that I'm using for this particular review. Argument will quickly come into play when it comes to the 1911 of caliber. Fires a 45 ACP. I always see the argument go one of two ways. You got a 9mm guy, he comes out and he goes, well, with modern 9mm loadings, you're equal in the power to a 45. Counter that with modern 45 caliber loadings, you have a exceptional killing machine. I have 45 caliber guys say the 45 caliber is amazingly strong and you don't need capacity because you have all that power. Well, that's definitely not the case. Multiple studies have proved that more rounds are better. So where does it fall? What it comes down to is shot placement and magazine capacity, 1000%. If you can't put your shot in the right place, it's not gonna matter. So if you're not a good shot in the first place, who the hell cares? If you have a good shot, awesome. Wouldn't you wanna have more rounds? Now, there's no doubt in my mind that the 45 is a more capable caliber than the 9mm. I'm not gonna argue or beleaguer that point. That being said, the reduced capacity is unfortunate when it comes to the 1911. It's the thing that really holds the weapon back. Now, when it comes to the recoil of the M45A1, it is incredibly gentle. So a 9mm feels very snappy. It's a quick push. The M45 is a gentle, long push. And especially with the M45, with the dual recoil assembly and all that weight out front, it's very gentle to fire this thing rapid fire. It just, when it comes back into battery, so you get that recoil, comes back. As it comes forward, it just brings the gun right back into target. Perfect spot. Every time you're pulling that trigger, you're just putting around almost on top of one another. It's been a real pleasure to shoot them. One thing I've always loved about 45, I feel like I'm in a Michael Mann movie now, but I love the report. The report of like a 9mm comparison sounds like a yippie dog. The 45 is a very deep thud. I know I'm waxing nostalgic about the 45, but I love the way the 45 sounds when you pull that trigger and you get that first shot. This feels and sounds wonderful. As far as combat effectiveness, it's not obsolete, but it is obsolescent. There are many other service weapons that are far more capable than the M45A1, both due to capacity, ergonomics, and reliability and a couple other things. Not to say that the M45A1 isn't reliable, but the 1911 will begin to gum up and slow down after about 300 or 400 rounds. Is this gonna happen in combat? No, but my point is that they gum up far sooner than a modern service weapon does and require cleaning much more frequently than a modern service weapon will. I'm sure all the people are coming in here to go yell about that right now. Fact of the matter is, modern service weapons are just a little bit more reliable. And I'm not saying this isn't a reliable weapon, because again, Army tests have proved that it's a very reliable weapon system. I'm just saying that, guess what, in the last 100 years, handgun technology has improved over what John Moses Browning originally designed. His designs were leaping boards to better handguns, and because of him, we have phenomenal handguns. But understand that the 1911 is outclassed, including the M45A1. So if you're thinking about using this as a duty weapon, I would recommend against it. If you're thinking of using it as a concealed carry weapon, I would recommend against it. If this is what you already have, I'll say this, train with it. That's what matters, ladies and gentlemen. If you can't shoot, it doesn't freaking matter. So get out there and get training. Bear Solutions, Cogworks, Esoteric, Darcy, all these guys have training, Pat McNamara, Larry Vickers. All these people can teach you stuff to make you better at shooting, which is what really matters. The gun, yeah, I mean, get yourself a reliable weapon, but otherwise, it's all about you. So make sure you get out there. Ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate you guys watching. The M45A1 is undoubtedly a cool and a sick gun. It serves its purpose, and as far as a collector's piece for shooting and having a good time, can't beat it. It freaking rocks. Just think about what purpose you want with this handgun and go from there. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching. I got nothing else for you. Okay, final thing for you guys. Going into holidays, it can be a really tough time for a lot of people. So my, I guess you were gonna say, call to action for today is I want you to, after you watch this video, reach out to someone maybe you haven't talked to in a while, or just a friend, or just let them know that you like them, you think they're pretty damn cool, and you care about them. Whether it be an old military service buddy, somebody in your unit, somebody in your unit who PCS'd away, or got out, or ETS, or whatever, or an old friend from school, find somebody and let's make the world a better place by saying, hey, I care about you. Because a lot of people go through really hard times right now, and I know it's hard to think about that because life's going so good for everybody. But remember, there's people out there who need your help. And I think it's important to be there for them, because I know if I was having a hard time, I'd want somebody to be there for me and reach out for me. If you're having a hard time, ladies and gentlemen, you fucking matter. And your presence here on this earth makes it a better place. You may not believe that right now, but I believe it wholeheartedly. Stay in there, guys. I'm always here for you guys. Hit me up on Instagram or whatever. If you have any issues, I'll try to get back to you. I understand I'm really busy with military work, but our community will support you. Be nice to each other. Ladies and gentlemen, you know if you've gotten this far, what helps me out quite a bit is Patreon. So Patreon helps me with lights, cameras, lenses, memory cards, all that stuff that I break on a consistent basis. Because of the support from Patreon, my production value has been going way up. I can't thank you guys enough for making this, I don't know what we'd call this, this Grand Thumb thing happen much better. You guys are the best. And from deep down, thank you. Happy holidays, guys. Take care.